Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Bare Thoughts. Join us as we sit down today with Dhwaj to discuss sustainability, sanitary waste management, circularity, and mindfulness. Dhwaj spends a lot of time doing yoga, sitting, and then writing about this yoga and sitting. And this has been the core of his life for some time now. Now he's back in Bangalore to get to know his family at a deeper level after spending some years working as a volunteer in various different countries, mostly farming and many other gigs, where he was exchanging his skills for food and a bed. It was fantastic. He was thriving, he says. So before that, Dhwaj spent some time in Auroville, 4 months or so, where he was exposed to a bunch of ideas around sustainability and while working for a farm as well. And that's where he first began living very simply so as to not depend too much on the current economic system. On moving to Bangalore, he simply started upcycling waste at his family's steel factory because it was literally lying in front of him, which led to an initiative called CHoOS Wisely Straws, and then also to NeoX, an enterprise or a collective that is a point of collection incinerator, and it is the safest, smartest way to deal with sanitary waste. Sounds like we can all resonate with Dhwaj with what we are all experiencing today and how we're going about life. So listen on to see how he's making an impact and striving to leave the world better than he actually found it. Thank you so much for hopping on another podcast with us of Bare Thoughts. Really happy to have you here, Dhwaj.
Thank you, Mehul. I'm happy to be here, man.
Great. So first thing, just to start off and give an introduction to listeners and to really see who you are, can you start off by just telling us about yourself a little and also your kind of journey that you've had?
So this is what I had sent you. It's tricky always to, you know, answer this question, but I'm going to say what I sent you, which is the last few years has been super incredible. You know, like there's just been a lot of different things that I've been able to experience. Mm-hmm. It's so varied. Like it's right now what I'm doing is so different from what I was doing a year ago, and I've just been very lucky to be open to all of these different experiences. But essentially I moved back here to Bangalore about a year and a half ago, mm-hmm. more or less. I was just before that traveling like around for like 2 years or so. I was just working and volunteering in different parts of the world. Like there's this thing called work away, woofing. Mm-hmm. So through that, you know, just like working at permaculture farms, living in these different communities, just working my hands and learning about like how people live in different places, but also in different ways, like just these things. That was incredible. I mean, I don't want to begin talking too much about it here because I'd just go on the entire podcast and be filled with that. But it was humbling. It made me feel really light. It was incredible, you know, in like every way. Well, this entire thing started for me about 3-4 years ago, you know, here in Bangalore. I just started like slow down and try to become a little bit more, just slow down a little bit.
So I guess that connects really well to my next question, which is, I went through some of your websites and I saw a lot of things on meditation and mindfulness. So what exactly does sustainability and mindfulness mean to you?
Everything, man. I mean, mindfulness, everything. Sustainability is growing to become more meaningful in my life. But my life with and without mindfulness is almost like, you know, it's a flip. Like it's just hard to explain, but nothing. It's the only thing that gives me some sort of it's magical. it's tricky to say, but it just makes everything quite like incredible, you know, simple things, everyday things. And it also, it's given me a lot of like space between me and my thoughts and so on. So that helps, like, you know, one helps the other. Like when I think I started becoming more mindful, mm-hmm. I just started focusing on how I was living and how I was feeling doing the things that I'd be doing. Mm-hmm. And when it just sort of happened automatically that I felt the want or need for lesser, right? Just in my own life. So sustainability came in along those same lines. It's just like you realize how little you need if you can just sort of get a lot more from each thing that you do. You know, you stop needing so many things if you just get a lot of fulfillment, because essentially that's what we're trying to do, you know, like in some ways fulfill some sort of thing that's inside us. But anyway, so sustainability was like a very self journey, you know, like I just wanted to be self-sustainable. I wasn't trying to change the world or anything. I was just trying to live low-key. And yeah, that was in itself quite a task.
Yeah, for sure. It makes sense because you're also surrounded by a lot of things that are happening around you. So I get where you're coming from in terms of being mindful. But how do you kind of balance that with everything that's happening around you as well?
Again, you're asking me to sort of to tell you a message that sort of, I guess, like Buddhists and monks and all these people have been trying to say it through their things. So if I could tell you, it would be lovely, but I don't know how to say it.
I understand where you're coming from. So, okay, so you travel.
Things like the breath. I mean, if I'm being, yeah.
Sorry. I interrupted you, my bad.
No, please.
So yeah, I realized you mentioned you traveled a bunch and you were volunteering, learning about permaculture, learning about cultures itself, societies. So can you share with us some of your learnings and how that has kind of driven, how you applied that to sustainability as well? Because a lot of the time, we're always thinking sustainability is a field on its own, but actually we can learn various things and make that, frame that into sustainability.
Yeah, I guess for that, I'd like, you know, just so what sustainability is to me is just, you know, like using whatever is sort of around us locally to fulfill that what we want and need and so on, and to do that to its maximum potential without having to create a lot of waste, essentially, right? Like not sort of like cutting the frills, if you'd say, because like you can do a bunch of like different things and different actions and so, and those can just waste a lot of your energy. But if you just, it's like if I know how to, what I learned over these, you know, over these years, just through the traveling and just through being, like you were asking me earlier, like how I keep my balance or so. I think a lot of it has been just through the breath, you know, like through the breath, I've just sort of created a space. And this space is everything, Mehul. Like it's just literally, it's able to help me distance myself from all of the things that are going on around me. I'm sure you've heard this before, but like it's just a feeling that you can't really explain.
Yeah.
But then when I was in all these different communities and traveling, we would just be so happy with like so little. I mean, we would just it was liberating. I mean, you know, and all these different farms and so, we'd have like a certain number of we did very basic things, you know, like work at the farm or work at whatever different tasks that we had to do, manage all of these different communities. There's a bunch of different tasks, you have to be creative, but there was a sense of ease. There was no need to like rush, which is what I guess I was doing before all of this, you know, just like the same things, you eat, you sleep, you work, blah blah, but with the sense of ease, like there's no rush to like go anywhere and so on. Just, and I think the same thing for me carries on to like how I feel about sustainability and all of you know, like working with our current economic system in cities. So that I see and I understand that like it's too late and we can't just stop growing economically, like, you know, economic growth is quite important. I just feel like we can do the same thing, but we can just do it a little slower, you know.
Definitely. I think we have this pressure on us all the time, which we don't need to have. So I guess moving on from that, I think a lot of your initiatives right now comes from a lot of genuinity and authenticity. So can you speak a little bit about the two initiatives that you are working on? I came across the straws and also came about sanitary waste, right? So can you give us an introduction to both those?
Sure. So Choose Wisely was something I started a year and a half ago. You know, again, I was just upcycling steel scrap at a factory. And then I just started to wonder why steel straws aren't as common in cutlery as, you know, spoons and so on. And then we, in this journey and trying to like talk to restaurants and like trying to sell to them, we came to understand that one of the hassles is like, you know, keeping the stock, cleaning it and reusing it. Like they didn't know how to clean these straws. It was just too much work. A lot of places, a lot of bars and so use about 500,000 straws a day, which is insane. So, and if a place, for example, needs to use 5,000 single-use straws, they need to stock twice or thrice that amount, for example. So cleaning was an issue. which is why we started working on a machine that like is essentially a dishwasher for straws. We started doing that, like we made about for 6 months we made different prototypes, worked with like different consultants. People were kind enough to help us, and this like restaurant owners for that matter. And then we were able to design a machine, like a little, it's a quite a compact machine. It's a small machine. This essentially enabled you to quickly clean straws, so you could clean about 100-200 straws in 20-30 minutes. Wow. And it didn't take that much space or electricity and so on. So restaurants started adopting it. You know, we had a bunch of famous chains in Bangalore that started, okay, you know, this makes sense. And financially, it made sense for them. Environmentally, it made sense for them. Like, and nobody was happy with paper straws and so on.
Yeah.
So that was, you know, with the straws, it was just picking up. But of course, now restaurants are not that open.
Yeah. So I guess I'll get a thought of you on that. There's this huge kind of discussion now that because of COVID, single-use plastic is being used more.
Yeah, man.
So, and that's, I think, a false kind of assumption, unfortunately, but people are under the assumption that packaged or plastic or single-use is the way to go to maintain that hygiene. So what are your thoughts on that, and how do you think like we should be tackling this, even as a zero-waste enterprise that we are, and you're doing something with stainless steel straws? What are your thoughts on that?
I don't want to be too harsh, but I do think it's silly. I think we're taking, as a mass society, taking the easy way out again. It's just mechanical for our minds to go back to single-use material. You know, it's just the easy way out. Like, we're already having to think about so many different things. Nobody wants to be mindful now about this. Understandable. Mm-hmm. But then I feel like practically the only way to go right now would just... It's tricky to say. I can't say that we stick with metals, carry our own containers, because that is the right thing, but I don't know how many people are going to do it. You know? I don't know. I can't say that I have a precise answer for like how to slow this down. Like a few items like cutlery, of course, you can avoid. You can avoid straws and things by having your own. Containers, some people, I think a lot of people are you know, either picking up their own food in these containers and so on. The thing is, like, single-use plastic, you know, for that matter, we can't guarantee that it's foolproof. For that matter, you don't know where it comes from. We don't know about the supply chain. We don't know how a lot of restaurants stock it on a very regular basis every few days. And so, you know, my friends and I were actually talking about this some time ago, where say, for example, an ice cream parlor, one of these famous ice cream parlors and so on, they would need to like replenish stock every day. And I think the virus stays on plastic surfaces for like a few days, 3 days. So we don't really know how quickly it's circulating. And like, if it's going to pass hands anyway through people of delivery boys, it's going to happen anyway. So I don't think it's the safest thing. But yeah, logistically, I feel like it's tricky to find a definite answer. I can't say I know one.
Yeah, no worries. Thank you for shedding light on that, though. I mean, I totally understand. That's one of my thoughts as well, because it's being passed on. There's a supply chain. There's a life cycle. So there's a lot of things to consider. What about neo-sanitation? Can you talk a little bit more about that as well?
Yeah, man. So that's something that's really exciting just now. So this team, I ran into a team of researchers that was working on this machine for the last 7 years, in fact. And we started to work towards the end of their research, and when they had a product and had been running it for a while, they made this machine. Essentially, what NeoX is a POC incinerator. It's a point of collection incinerator. It is a machine that can incinerate sanitary waste, any toxic sanitary waste, whether it's any cloth-based, cotton-based items, as efficiently as an industrial incinerator can outside of the city. Actually, more efficiently, because a lot of these incinerators are not that efficient anymore. You know, it's been a long time since they've been running and so on. But the idea is to decentralize, and this is what NeoX does. It just, wherever the trash is, wherever the items are, waste is trashed, it can incinerate using very little electricity. And what's most important about incineration as a process is that you need to incinerate things at a certain temperature. This temperature needs to be, you can't have a machine take an hour or so to reach this temperature. Efficiency of incineration is important. How much air you're allowing, if it's aerobic combustion incineration, there's a bunch of factors, and all of these standards, they're very strict international standards. Even in the Indian standards are strict, but the international standards are, we feel, the ones to be followed. And this machine cracks all of these things, you know, like it's cracked the technology of how to incinerate efficiently. That's what NeoX does. But even though this is a machine that can burn at such high temperatures, we don't want to encourage people, like in India, how it is if you tell them it can burn waste, they'll put in any sort of waste.
Yeah.
So there's only a certain number of items, a list that once we've tested, say this item or that item, then we say, okay, you know, this can be put in the machine. This is what we're trying to control. We know that we can't always control it, but this is what we do. So we tested it for masks and so, for example. Oh, and all sorts of masks, like we're dealing with a new crisis now in terms of the bloody masks, like the single-use masks, because not everybody uses cotton masks. Like, it's insane how many reusable masks, because it's a business now.
But, so
it's a lot of waste created. So I mean, that, because there's a lot of single-use masks and so on, they have to be incinerated again. They can't be dumped in the landfill. So again, the machine does that, and people have been, you know, interested by that aspect of it, like by to deal with the waste. Because say something is COVID infected, a mask or so on, then instead of storing it and then use like a bunch of different hands touch it, and then it goes into, you know, the incineration facility outside the city. If you can just deal with it on the spot, it's a lot. The risk of contamination is contained. Like it's gone down tremendously.
I guess, but where, like, have you guys? You said you're working on decentralizing it, right?
Yeah.
So where all are you guys, like villages, or are you also jumping into metropolitan cities kind of thing?
So, dude, we have like a bunch of different verticals right now. So essentially we want two aspects of it. One, the government aspect, and then the private sector aspect, of course. So the government needs to implement this in a lot of spaces, whether it's waste management facilities, the BBMP facilities, and so on. They need, because they are struggling a lot, like, you know, they are struggling a lot with landfills being overwhelming and whatnot. So that's like, that looks very promising for us, because we've been focusing on that. And the only thing is that the government works a little slower than we'd like. The private sector, on the other hand, like, what we want really to do through decentralization is make this a community thing, man. I feel like we can't sit and install machines everywhere for people. And we can't start facilities where people are going to come and drop their waste. I want to do that. I want to start a few facilities around town where there's just like a complete holistic waste management facility, like the cleanest ways to deal with waste. But just now we've just installed machines in like, you know, a bunch of schools, a bunch of tech parks that have been like open to doing it. Some homes, like in my house, I installed a machine and I collect sanitary waste from like some people around us. Just like, you know, in nearby houses and so on. And and so we can reduce, like, even if you can reduce 100 200 pads every few weeks going to a landfill, that makes a big difference. So in one community we share this sort of incinerator, you know. So these are different things that can be done, and we don't have to depend on, like, in an apartment, for example, Mehul, like if there are like, I don't know, 100 homes even, then if each person pays about 600 rupees, they can buy the machine. The machine is about like 65,000 rupees. And if they can do that, then the cost is nothing. The cost of running it is nothing. Each cycle is like 0.2 units of electricity, which means you're spending, to burn 50 pads, you're spending 1 rupee 60 paisa. It's nothing.
Cool, awesome. And can you tell us, I guess, a little bit more about the inspiration behind you wanting to be part of something like this? For example, what really, I mean, a lot of listeners may not know, so what really is the problem with sanitary waste that we're facing?
Well, I had not too much of an idea about the sanitary waste management before. I mean, waste in general, I knew that, of course, we create a lot more waste and so on. I learned a lot during the CHoOS wisely plastic straw thing. But then I realized that sanitary waste, like sanitary napkins, for example, are like, you know, the waste we create as a country is huge. And this is only when about 10-15% of our women have access to sanitary, the sanitation, like to pads and so on. This number is only increasing, you know. A lot of initiatives have been started in the last couple of years where, you know, more and more rural areas and like semi-urban areas, people are provided with like a sanitary napkin. So this waste is going to increase, and we do want to move on to like greener alternate ways, like, you know, maybe maybe cloth pads again or menstrual cups, but that's going to take a long time, man. And we're still going to be generating this waste. It's just the inspiration is just simply like how much waste there is, and like how I'm just, you know, like meditating on how we're not like disconnected from this waste. Like if all this waste is created, it's all cyclical, man. Like it's just because we've been distanced as a, you know, as a structure. How we work as cities and so on, we're very distanced, as like, you know, we're privileged, so we don't, it's not in my backyard sort of thing. But I mean, the connections are there for you to see, you know. You can, the air you breathe, the, you know, the landfills, seepage is going into the water. Bangalore has one of the worst water table indexes. Like the irrigation water that's available to farmers in the outskirts, those who don't have access, most don't have access to like you know, clean water that's gone through some sort of plants. They just have to take what's there, and it's filthy. We know about our lakes and so on. It's just filthy water being used to grow our food. So it doesn't matter where you buy your food from or what tags they have. It's, the water is bad. So, you know, it's you're eating this. So there's lots of connections. Like there's so many connections. And if you can, like, if you just become, so again, this was a very personal thing for me, where being mindful, or, you know, I don't know, the practice of yoga, or just sitting down and just like being sort of more in sync with your body, you feel like these little changes, or like, you know, you can tell if the food is good or bad or so on and so forth. There's just connections for you to see and make, some practically and some theoretically, because you can't feel everything. But yeah,
makes sense. I mean, I think we need to break it down a little, slow down, like you said, break it down and realize that there's a lot of things that happen behind the scenes, behind that price point, behind the packaging, and then you realize that there's farmers behind it, there's people that are livelihoods depend on certain things. So I think that helps us become more aware as well. And with what's happening today, I am an optimist, so I would like to think that there's a lot more awareness today than there was before this was happening as well. So I think that's a great kind of segue to my question to you, where you said it's cyclical. So there's the linear economy and there's the circular economy, right? So what are your thoughts on incorporating circularity into the economic system, and how do you kind of practice that today with neo-sanitation or your straws?
So I mean, that's that's something that I find I've found incredible, that like I think a lot of people or businesses, from what I've come to understand, feel that being circular in the way they do things, are being sustainable, is a luxury, and it's going to cost them a lot more. But like, simply speaking, if you're just a circular economy is about, like, you know, using all the waste that you create, and like, you know, not just like everything has a sort of use, it uses an input for something else and so on. This makes a business more lean. Like as a businessman, if I can call myself that, like, you know, this it just makes a lot more financial sense, and like it makes you more lean as a business. And going forward, it's not going to be an option. Like your business are not going to have the luxury to choose, I feel, if they want to be sustainable. Resources are just cutting down solid. Like we all can feel it. Like you think there's a lot of water today. There's not, if you study, there's not going to be a lot of water soon. There's just not going to be a lot of things available. So it's not going to be an option to be circular or to not be circular. As a business. And with Neo, for example, like, you know, in the beginning with CHoOS, obviously it was easier to do, like simple things of how we package, where we source from. Like we wouldn't source steel or steel straws from China, for that matter, because say we're trying to cut down plastic, right, for example. And if we were to import all our steel from China, then the cargo, the fuel used there, the plastic used to package, it's just going to cut everything. Like it's just pointless. So like source locally, and it doesn't have to be that expensive. Again, when that we think it's expensive to source locally and so on. No, I feel like if more people do it, there is no demand here as such. The prices are higher because people don't do it. But if more people follow this, then there's a bigger market and so on, you know, like that'll fix itself. It's not a problem. So with that, and with how we package it, how we send it for that matter, like we wouldn't have unnecessary like a delivery van. Also, like we in the beginning, for example, we would just make like a bunch of deliveries ourselves, like at a certain time. It was just little things to choose. So I see with Neo, I'm finding it a little bit more challenging to run the business more like, you know, like completely sustainably. Little things that I'm doing is like, you know, again, recycled packaging is one of the things. Any materials that we use for research and prototyping, and like all of those, like raw materials for that matter, we make sure like all of them have some use, because they all can have some use or the other. They go to, we have an upcycling plant. We upcycle steel waste, electronic waste. You know, there's silicone. Like, there's a lot of use for all of the, for all of these things. So we just try to be like a little bit more mindful about that. It's a little tricky because you're working not alone. You're not working in a bubble. You're working with a lot of organizations. You know, you have to depend on like your suppliers and blah blah blah. So yeah. I can't pretend that it's green completely. But yeah. We try to do what we can, like, you know, internally and so on.
Yeah, and I think that's a great point. I mean, a lot of consumers, when they think sustainable, they think 100% sustainability, but we all need to realize that it takes time, you know, like step by step, there's innovations that need to happen. There's supply chains that need to change. There's partnerships that might need to happen. So that's a great point. And that's also a way for consumers to also realize that they have the power to invest in certain things with their wallets, kind of thing. And based on that, we can drive that innovation or drive that those collaborations that we need. So, just in a concluding factor, I'm learning a lot from you. So I just want to kind of share a piece of advice that you probably you can have or provide to aspiring eco-entrepreneurs or intrapreneurs as well. So people within a business itself, what kind of advice do you have for them to see if they can make any impact or if they can become more mindful and sustainable in their lifestyles?
Honestly, I think one of the things like that's helped me a long way is to not feel overwhelmed or scared, you know, like which goes back to like, you know, building myself up to the task. Like I'd say that, you know, create some sort of space, like work on yourself for that matter in whatever way you choose to, but I'd say like try to create a space between you and like all of these things that you do, because it goes a long way. Like it's taken away a lot of fear, like, you know, like it doesn't really matter if things completely work out always in your favor, because I mean, we have to just realize that, you know, we're essentially all, might sound like a naive comment, but it's essentially all on the same team. And it's just like our fears that make us take quick and protective action. And we're not able to see clearly because of all of these judgment errors. I think that this space helps a lot, man. Like, you know, just between you and all of this, you do your thoughts and so on. It's a practice. I'd say if you do that, it sort of goes into everything that you do. You're able to just see with more clarity. You're able to like make decisions without, you know, feeling like, oh, what if this fails and so on. And also when you sort of do this, like for me, I realize that I genuinely just don't need so much to live, you know, to thrive on. Like I'll be fine, not even fine, like fantastic without. I think a lot of businesses are trying to make owners of businesses because we have a certain idea of comfort and lifestyles and so on. But like, if you can just sort of feel or understand, I don't think you can like purely intellectually, I don't think that lasts very long. But if you can feel that, oh, hey, you know, like I don't need so much to be comfortable, then you can still, I'm not saying it's wrong or right to want to make money. I'm just saying you should do either of those things without fear, because then you just have more clarity. That's all. I mean, I don't know if this all made sense. It did in my head, but
it makes sense to me, and I think we definitely broke it down really well. That's actually the end of the podcast, and I really enjoyed speaking with you. Experience, I mean, learning about the different initiatives you're doing, the way you came about also doing this is something that people can resonate with. So thank you so much for breaking it down for us. Thank you for hopping on this podcast as well.
Please. Thank you, Mail. Thank you all for listening.
Thank you for all tuning in to another episode of Bare Thoughts. We hope you had fun listening to this conversation and also simply understand that if we put our mind to becoming change makers, we can all become change makers in various capacities. Thank you for listening.